there's a light under the sun, under the sun, under the sun, under the sun, under the sun.
The message, "Everybody's got a little light under the sun," appeared at the Toronto Sculpture Garden in May 2005. This message was written upon an LED sign that framed a climbing dome situated beneath a mirror ball. This sign and the mirror ball's motor were powered by two sources, which were contingent both on the climate's variations and the activities of the garden's visitors. A solar panel captured available sunlight and converted it to electrical energy. Alternately, bicycle pedals attached to hidden electrical generators also transformed visitors' muscle power into electricity. The sun's energy powered the motor of the rotating mirror ball suspended above a geodesic climbing dome that was the central focus of the entire installation. This dome, and the playful behavior it elicited, was observed from a platform equipped with seating and the bicycle pedals that transformed the energy voluntarily exerted by visitors into electricity to power the LED sign overhead. Everybody's got a little light. Flashlight was the site of a utopian proposal. Its LED message was derived from the Parliament song Flashlight, written by George Clinton, Bernie Worrell, and Bootsy Colliins. This message established a relationship between the installation as a whole and the aspirations for self-transcendence and social union embodied in funk culture from the 1970s. Installed at the Toronto Sculpture Garden in 2005, the sculptural ensemble proposed that playful personal interaction is a source of power parallel to the natural power of the sun under which we are all equal. The sun shines in the same way for rich and poor, for citizen and alien, for bodies black, brown, red, yellow, and white. Equally, we each carry within us an inner spark, an innate agency to manifest individually and to concentrate collectively within that regulated and regimented terrain known as the public sphere. At a time like today, marked by oil wars, electrical blackouts, rising energy costs, increasing awareness of the unsustainability of our manners of consumption, and a fiercely contested socio-political realm that is redefining the meaning of democracy within global capitalism, Flashlight can be seen as a utopian proposition from what may well be an as yet untapped form of power. This sculptural project is indebted to the cross-pollination of ideas within my artistic milieu in Toronto, among works that include the collective projects of the October Group in 1996 and the February Group in 1997, Adrian Blackwell's Public Water Closet of 1998 and Model for a Public Space of 1999-2000, Kika Thorne's video work of 1999, Sandy Plotnikov's edition Hat Scene, and Paige Gratland and Dave Millman's action Free Dance Lessons, both of 2001. All these projects share an interest in generating interactions among people that are formed through situations of playful and exploratory participation. The relational aesthetics of these projects involves open-ended personal interaction and communal free play. In a capitalist society such as our own, it is understood that social experience must be instrumentalized into cycles of alienated production and spectacularized consumption. All social experience must increasingly conform to this cycle of making and buying. Other forms of social experience must be rendered more and more untenable. Within this capitalist social context, artists such as Thorne, Blackwell, Plotnikoff, Gratland, and Milman have turned their energies towards developing, in their work, new experiential forms of social interaction and collective participation. Their artistic practice and social activism have created a rich discursive context for relational aesthetics in Toronto. Flashlight emerges from this fertile ground. Flashlight is a hybridizing work where two relatively autonomous systems are made to energize and to arouse a new third system. In the first place, there is the cosmic system formed by the Earth in rotation around its axis and in orbit around the Sun, from which it receives energy in the form of solar rays. This system is of particular importance for us, since it is the foundation of all organic life, including our own. This cosmic system comes into contact with a second system that is social in nature. This second system is composed by the many uses of territory, of land in the cities, that in the form of social norms express interests that mutually conflict, endorse, and transform one another. To enter a public park is to enter into this social system, this constellation of personal interests expressed by behavior and structured by law. For some of us, this experience of entering a public park is free of trouble and is conducive to leisure, fun, and relaxation. For others of us, this experience is frequently vexing, even intolerable. These two relatively autonomous systems are made to touch upon each other in Flashlight. The cosmic system enters the project from above, and its point of entry is the solar panel. The social system enters the project from below, and its point of entry is the platform equipped with bicycle pedals, from which are visible the playground climbing dome and the myriad of relations the park's visitors establish with it. In both the lighting up of the LED message and the activated rotation of the mirror ball, this overlaying of systems energizes a third, now emergent presence. Funk culture that came to prominence during the 1970s, and that, in the mutating forms of electro-funk, post-punk, no-wave, hip-hop, Chicago house, acid house, and Detroit techno, remains a resounding message in both the popular and mass corporate music cultures of North America. Funk culture strives to produce a social experience of togetherness that weaves through racial lines and other divisions between people by prioritizing a bodily, interpersonal, and spiritual connection with rhythm. This identification with rhythm is understood to be innate. It is already present within all people regardless of background, and thereby forming the basis for communality. Funk culture is sometimes seen as the survival of African philosophy and spirituality that accompanied people forcibly brought by the slavery system to the Americas, preserved through the years in the musical forms of African percussion, slaves' work chants, gospel song, blues, jazz, rhythm and blues, rock and roll, soul, and funk. Funk is primarily an experience. It is something you perceive not by observing it at a distance, but only by taking part in it. It is something you feel with others. This experience is something intrinsically connected to embodiment. Funk is a feeling that rises as a funky smell emerging from our active bodies. the experience of funk can certainly produce a high, but a high that comes from the low. It is a high that emerges from our bodies in action, and from the lowest part in harmonic music, the rhythmic bass. From this lowliness, funk uplifts. It is this experiential and participatory dimension of being with others that connects funk culture with the relational aesthetics that came to prominence in contemporary art during the 1990s. And that continues as a strong current in art at the beginning of the new century. But a peculiar theatricality appears in Flashlight and its various props. The LED sign serves as backdrop or caption to the activities unfolding on the geodesic play structure below. And these activities are observed from the comfortable seating of a viewing platform. Whatever play may occur between visitors upon the climbing dome, it occurs in fictional form as a kind of performance. Flashlight is premised on the idea that, in the time between the 70s and today, we have become the children of a new, colonized form of experience, the everyday experience of a certain kind of social space that is itself based upon fiction. In privatized public amenities, of which the recent development of Dundas Square in Toronto provides a striking instance, our experience of being social is fictional in a way that today is eminently common and everyday. Such public spaces are made using semi-sculptural, semi-theatrical furniture and other props to dramatize an invitation to gregariousness and conviviality. This invitation is simultaneously undone, however, by various means: the prior selection of users, built-in physical discomfort, that is, design intended to be comfortable only for predictable uses and for measurable durations, an aesthetics of desolateness and openness, and techniques of surveillance and privatized management. More and more, this is what we recognize as public space, the staging of the commons, the management of the experience of being with others, the fiction of being public. The theatricized and quasi-fictional character of togetherness that such public space is intended to provide is the physical form of the private tinge to public involvement that Dundas Square so forcefully embodies. The message that funk culture presented in the 1970s was one of unity, spontaneous interaction, shameless bodily expression, and self-transcendence. If any of this appears in Flashlight, it comes to light as a utopia, a fleeting and unstable apparition, in the sparkling of a mirror ball and the ephemeral illumination of an LED diode. Play appears today only as a cipher, and the relational aesthetics of Flashlight appears as a stand-in for actual liberation. We can almost hear the visitor to the sculpture garden, who in playing makes the move to become a participant of Flashlight. I play as if I were free. I act as if I was playing, because the only form of play that I can accomplish is symbolic. My playing is an art. My playing is theatrical. The geodesic climbing dome circumscribes a large pregnant space which does not itself appear. This structure around which all the other elements of the installation are oriented, is a cipher, a spherical non-sight, a placeholder, like the number zero in a sequence of digits, that designates the possibility for something to happen. What is this something that is also an unregulated event? We call it play. The modern industrial promise of liberation from work, where human potential may finally be realized through creation in free time, is today being undone through the gradual atomization of part-timing and precarious employment, and the hastening commercialization and branding of popular experience. And the Canadian welfare state promise of the publicness of essential infrastructure, such as electrical power, and social services, such as education and culture, against the invisible hand of private interests, is today being dismantled part by part through the commercialization of both social interaction and the surfaces of urban space. Flashlight is a model for a kind of play, a kind of dance, a kind of joyous interaction within a playground that does not exist here, except as an unfulfilled promise made by the recent past, and which the present is its disavowal. The third system arises in this context to appear almost like the nonconformism of artistic autonomy and freedom, and not quite as an affirmation of a bureaucratized notion of arts in the community. Funk must be born freakishly, arising as if from the earth itself in the form of a weird geodesic mothership. It calls for a collective act of cultural misappropriation and a transformative botched rehearsal performed in the service of the promise of liberation, pleasure, and togetherness. The performance of play within the confines of the city and its routines, the enacting of childlike abandon and spontaneity and collective pleasure can perhaps manifest itself today in our docile bodies only theatrically, only as a fantasy. But this fantasy is up for grabs. It can be shaped into customized interaction and managed conviviality, or else into a spontaneous moment of experimental action. For even within these bodies, our experience of the abstract rule of capital is one of marginalization and dispossession, and a segregation that is merely half-willed. The ritual of theatricized play was enacted at the Toronto Sculpture Garden by students from the George Brown campus east on King Street, by office workers en route from the financial district to the west, and by families and tourists coming to shop in the Old Toronto of Front Street and the St. Lawrence Market. In Flashlight, our participation occurred beneath the rhetorical presence of a mirror ball that scintillated and spun in a revolution that was daily renewed and was powered by an indefatigable cosmic source. Our collective performance of playfulness took place in front of the declarative presence of an LED sign lit up by the social power of our own active bodies. If collective play was ever to occur within Flashlight, it would be born twisted, but as its own reward. Feet don't fail me now. I just can't find the bay. Flashlight.
Under the sun.